Good afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? And please observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. And please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The first item of business is a statement by Shirley Ann Somerville on National Qualifications 2021. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Shirley Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome this opportunity to provide an update on the awarding of qualifications this year. And it's a privilege as well as a huge responsibility to have returned to the portfolio at such a critical time for Scottish education. The exceptional level of collaboration in supporting our learners, particularly during the pandemic, has been striking, and I am determined that such constructive engagement is maintained going forward. Ensuring our young people are kept safe and are able to achieve fair and credible grades, in spite of the most challenging of school years, has been and remains this government's absolute priority. I take very seriously the anxiety and concern voiced by some young people, parents and teachers about the approach being taken, an approach that I and key stakeholders across our system firmly believe to be the fairest possible for our young people in the challenging circumstances due to the pandemic. In response to the concerns I have heard, my statement will restate some key principles about the model, provide detail on the support available to learners, set out how this year's appeals process will work to support learners, acknowledge work to safeguard opportunities for this year's learners to progress to further and higher education, and provide an update concerning the OECD review into the curriculum. The disruption generated by the COVID-19 pandemic caused by this year's National 5 higher and advanced higher exams to be cancelled. The National Qualifications 2021 group was established in October 2020 with representatives of teachers, learners and parents working alongside local authorities, the SQA and government to ensure that the hard work of learners can be fairly acknowledged. This group agreed and co-produced the model for this year, using their insight and expertise. Education partners continue to support the approach. So let me be clear about the assessment process itself. At the heart of the model are the professional judgments of teachers and lecturers based on what learners have demonstrated they have attained. It is those judgments alone, based on learners' work, that this year will determine the grades that young people receive. Those grades will not be based on any historical data or the use of an algorithm, but based on what each individual learner has demonstrated they know, understand and can do through the work they have been assessed on in a school or college. That is the key difference this year compared to last. So my key message to reassure learners is this: your grades will be judged by your teachers based on your work. I'm enormously grateful for the efforts of our teachers, lecturers and others in schools and colleges who are implementing the model to ensure fairness for all learners. To provide evidence of how the model is being implemented locally, HMI Inspectors of Education have today published a review of local authority quality assurance processes. The key findings from the review provide independent evidence of the model working well in practice. With local authority officers, headteachers, SQA coordinators and teachers having collaborated to ensure that the efforts of young people are appropriately recognised, and with local authorities having supported schools to implement the model to reflect their own local context whilst working within a national framework. Despite the best efforts, there are a very small number of learners who have completed courses but have over recent weeks experienced particularly significant disruption that has meant that they have been unable to complete their assessments. Contingency arrangements are in place for later certification for this group, and the National Qualifications 2021 group are publishing details of this today. Now, I fully appreciate that there are those who disagree with the model that is in place, but to those I say that teachers, learners and parents and carers have been listened to, and this model is the result of that. Awarding qualifications will always be challenging under these circumstances, but we believe that the model we have is the fairest solution in the interests of young people. And this isn't just my conclusion, but that of the National Qualifications 2021 Group 2. Now, this is not to dismiss in any way the concerns and anxiety expressed by some learners and parents who are experiencing the implementation of the model firsthand. And as a result, I am today announcing a package of support measures for those learners. Many of these are available now and others will be added to in the coming weeks. To date, we have provided over £400 million additional funding to local authorities to support schools to cope with and recover from the effects of COVID. This includes further digital devices, additional staffing and wider support. We have continued to support schools and local authorities deliver their vital role in supporting children and young people's mental health and well-being. However, we recognise that young people may need further support and therefore a letter will be sent to the home address of every learner taking national qualifications to outline support available and to provide links to online resources and helpline numbers. Learners may well have questions regarding their progression beyond school. And for those continuing with education, the SQA, UCAS and College and University Advice Lines will be there to provide support. Those moving on to employment can draw support from Skills Development Scotland advisers. We're also working with Young Scot, who, as experts in successfully communicating with learners, will be promoting the support available through their social media feeds and their website. Now, whilst every effort has been taken to ensure that the hard work of learners is fairly acknowledged in the first instance, with learners getting the right result first time, the appeals process is an important final stage to that certification process. The SQA is today publishing details of that process, and, Presiding Officer, I can confirm that the approach will, for the first time, include a direct right of appeal for learners. I am sure this will be welcomed by learners and their representatives. It is right in these exceptional times that there is a broad mechanism to appeal for those who consider they have not received the right result, and that this is free at point of use. To ensure fairness and credibility, the grounds for appeal are disagreement with the Centre's quality-assured academic judgment, contested administrative or procedural error within the SQA or the Centre, and appeals related to the Equality Act, including assessment arrangements. Education stakeholders have been clear that demonstrated attainment is a key principle in ensuring credibility and fairness of the qualifications, and so appeals decisions will be evidence-based and symmetric, meaning that grades can move down, up or stay the same depending on the review of the evidence. I recognise that some stakeholders are not supportive of this position and would seek an approach where grades cannot go down. And while I am really sympathetic to the position of learners this year, awards must ultimately be based on the actual attainment of pupils. That means that the subject specialist looking at an appeal must be able to give their true judgment on a pupil's attainment, moving the grade in line with the evidence. In this way, the appeal system will be fair, consistent and credible. Without symmetry, there would not be a full and fair review of the evidence. This could be perceived as unfair to other learners and raise questions over the credibility of the qualifications this year. In adopting a symmetrical approach to appeals, judgments at appeal will be on an individual learner's work only and not on an algorithm or on a school's past performance. While the formal processing of appeals will not start until learners receive their results on the 10th of August, learners will be able to indicate their intention to appeal from late June when provisional results are submitted. Support will be in place for learners over this period. Our learners also need reassurance that having received their grades, those who wish to continue their learner journey should be able to do so. We understand that the changes to the SQA process last year and this year may impact students looking to undertake courses in Scotland's colleges and universities in the new academic year. We will, via the Scottish Funding Council, continue to provide additional support to our institutions to ensure that students are able to take up places they would otherwise not have secured without additional places being made available. In 2020-21, the SFC provided universities with an additional 1,297 places for students impacted by the SQA changes. And in 21-22, we will continue to fund those places while having made provision for further additional places, currently estimated to be around 2,500 for new students. Colleges have also been supported to deliver additional flexibility within their courses. Presiding Officer, the COVID-19 pandemic has presented unprecedented challenges for our education system. It has sparked debate about the future of assessment and qualifications, the best way to recognise learners' achievements, and equip them with the skills required to succeed in whatever path they might choose. Members will be aware we extended the remit of the OECD's review to analyse Scotland's approach to assessment and qualifications and develop options to enhance our approach. This work is ongoing and will be published by the OECD in early autumn. Before then, however, I can confirm today that the OECD will publish its main report on the review of curriculum for excellence on the 21st of June, and I look forward to discussing their findings with Parliament before summer recess. Presiding Officer, I relish the prospect of exploring a wide range of reform opportunities which will further improve Scottish education, but my immediate focus remains, of course, on ensuring that we do right by all learners taking national qualifications this year. I can reassure the Chamber that everything is being done to ensure that the hard work of learners is recognised fairly at a time that will naturally be an anxious and a stressful one for many learners and for their families. And I ask members to acknowledge the merits of the approach being taken and to play their part in reassuring and supporting learners during these challenging times.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And it would be appreciated if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and may I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. Last year's exam chaos was unacceptable, but the failure to learn lessons is unforgivable. For us to be in a worse position than this time last year is a betrayal of our young people. We have seen inconsistent approaches school to school, never mind local authority to local authority. Confusion over what counts as evidence of attainment. Pupils being told exams were cancelled, then facing exams in all but name. But worst of all, today we've had confirmation that SQA assessment papers are widely available online on an industrial scale. On what planet is this fair or robust? And how on earth does the Cabinet Secretary explain the astonishing naivety and incompetence of the SQA?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I said in my statement, I appreciate there will be different grounds where people will like or dislike parts of this statement. But I think it is unfair, not on me or the government, because I don't expect that that's Oliver Mundell's problem. But I think on the other stakeholders who have worked in the National Qualifications 21 group to say that this is a failure. When I quote from Larry Flanagan, a quote from the EIS, who said recently that the alternative certification model gives the best opportunity to demonstrate what individuals have learned. The General Secretary of the School Leaders Scotland, Jim Thewlis, who noted earlier in May that the system that replaced the exams were never going to be perfect, but all the way along no one has come up with a better way of doing it than the alternative certification model. So I appreciate people may not like the system that is in place, but as the National Qualifications 21 group have looked at very seriously, this is the best option and the fairest option for our young people. So this isn't a system that the government has came up with, but something that we have worked very hard with stakeholders and with others. There are, of course, aspects which are causing concern out there, and I do realise there have been discussions previously in the Chamber around some materials being available online. Can I point to the fact that teachers and lecturers have flexibility to decide how and when to use materials? There is not one exam paper. This is very different to a usual year. So the SQA have provided a wealth of materials which teachers can choose or not to use. So the incidents, of course, of sharing material are taken very seriously, but this is very, very different to a normal year where there is one exam question, for example, that might have been taken on board.
I call Michael Mara to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you, Minister, for citing the statement in the last hour. Just minutes ago, I was contacted by an angry mother. Hers was the latest of very many. And her daughter is in the midst of 28 exams over 35 days. Her friends have even more, and many of these exams are scheduled on the same day. This has been typical. So following last year's SQA scandal, the government was instructed in September, 9 months ago, that young people must have the opportunity of appeal. On six different occasions, the SQA promised the publication of a robust appeals process. The SQA has missed its own deadlines time and again to publish the process and to give teachers, families and young people the clarity and certainty that they deserve. So this publication of this process that we haven't as yet seen is now well over a month late, and there is just now over 20 days until teachers must submit the grades of their pupils. Many young people have already completed the assessments. So the statement today does confirm that these are high-stake examinations. Exam papers have been shared, exams have been retaken over time again to improve grades, and through all this, teachers are struggling on to do the best for their pupils. But there is no real process in this statement, given the acute public interest, and I don't see why we haven't had it provided. But we do agree that there should be an appeals process that has to be in the hands of the pupil.
Question,
the alternative,
please.
If it can, the alternative was schools appealing against their own judgment. So my questions: what support will be put in place to ensure young people can access their right of appeal? What evidence will be required for a young person to lodge an appeal, particularly given that the process for many has already passed and as such their opportunity to collate their own evidence? And please remember within that that many of the most disadvantaged pupils are those who may wish to avail themselves of it. And how will young people know that their assessment process has been disadvantaged them, given that the assessment process are so wildly varied in 1,000 different ways across hundreds of schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there is variability across hundreds and thousands of schools, because if we didn't have variability, we would have central diktat from central government. And if we did, Michael Mara would quite rightly be pointing out that that's not the way to run an education system. So we have variability to ensure that schools can best put in place what is right for them, and most particularly for their pupils. It is very, very important that, of course, schools are supported in that process to ensure that there is national standards, national guidelines, and I spoke about the work that we've done, HMIE have done and published today to reassure around the standards that are there and to ensure that variability is there to support flexibility, but within national standards. But I can say, I have to absolutely strongly disagree with Michael Mara. There is nothing that is coming from the Scottish Government or the SQA which requires high-stake examinations. That is not how the system has been designed by the group that has been in charge and responsible for co-producing that with Scottish Government. There may be more assessments than an individual would have set exams, but that's because teachers and schools are breaking these down into smaller assessments to ensure that pupils are supported during that process. He talks about the support that's available. I mentioned in my statement about the letter that will be going out to learners, which is an integral part of the support we'll be doing, but only one part of that. And I also mentioned for the grounds of appeal that will be available, and there will be further details coming from that from the SQA today, and the evidence will be that there has already been collected for the exams. And I think probably, Presiding Officer, I should leave it there.
Thank you. Ross Greer to be followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. The lack of a no-detriment approach to appeals means young people and their teachers will be taking a perverse gamble this year. Schools will submit the strongest evidence they have in support of the initial grade. Why would they have stronger evidence suitable for an appeal, but which they chose not to submit in the first place? It seems the risk of downgrading is increased by an appeals process reliant just as much on demonstrated rather than inferred attainment and based on evidence likely to be weaker than that originally submitted. I noticed the Cabinet Secretary mentioned the National Qualifications Group signed off on the certification model itself. Can she confirm if the whole National Qualifications Group have signed off and endorsed this appeals process? Could she also confirm whether or not young people will be given the same opportunity to ask questions directly of the SQA that teachers and parents already have? And can she clarify why it appears exceptional individual circumstances, such as immediate family bereavement due to COVID, will not be considered grounds for appeal?
Cabinet Secretary.
So a lot to cover in there, Presiding Officer, so I shall try and get through as much as I can. I mentioned about the symmetrical approach in my statement, and we do believe, and I believe, that that is the fairest way forward. That ensures that learners will receive grades as consistently as possible in the circumstances, with the evidence of learners' attainment being judged against national standards. It is very important that it is based on demonstrated attainment. I do appreciate that some people are concerned around the risk of downgrading. Can I point out how exceptionally rare downgrading actually is? So in 2017, 8 people were downgraded from 13,998 appeals. In 2018, it was 7 people from 13,000 and 63, and in 2019 it was one person from 11,138. Of course, it is an exceptionally rare process, but even if it is considered rare, though that is, we will ensure that that downgrading decision is also further reviewed within the SQA to ensure that that's the right decision for that learner. So it is something that's taken very seriously, but I can assure people it is done very, very rarely.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One constituent told me this model is the worst that could ever possibly have happened. Stress, uncertainty, assessment after assessment with no study leave. Pupils have told me they've got 16 assessments this week, and it's a nightmare for teachers too. Liberal Democrats have called for the reform of the SQA for years. There are no excuses left. Last week, I asked about fast access to mental health support. The Cabinet Secretary says this is a naturally stressful time, but does she accept that the mismanagement of this year's exam has increased stress levels, and will pupils see extra support to help with that extra anxiety?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I absolutely take on board the response that Beatrice Wishart has had from a constituent. I can assure her I've had those thoughts fed back to me directly from some young people, parents and teachers as well. But what I also have to take on board is the work that has been done by the NQ21 group that remains supportive of the model that's been developed. And that includes education stakeholders such as the EIS and ADES. And they believe that this is the right and the fairest mechanism that's out there. I appreciate in this portfolio there is not one ready answer that will be agreeable to all stakeholders, but I can assure Beatrice Wishart and others I have listened very, very carefully to those that have concerns about it. I've listened very carefully to all stakeholders, and I still believe, as the NQ21 group do too, that this is the fairest option that is out there, that we can reassure young people that they will get the grades based on demonstrated attainment in a fair and a credible way.
Thank you. I'm very keen to get all who've pressed in, but I'd be very appreciative if we could have shorter questions and responses. And I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Pam Gossel.
In paying tribute to the work of our schools, our teachers and our pupils at this difficult time, I am concerned by the volume of my mailbox, as anxiety is high amongst parents and carers over the ongoing assessments. How can the Scottish Government ensure equity and quality control across different assessment models?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank Claire Adamson for the question, and I follow on from what I said to Beatrice Wishart. I am very, very determined to ensure that the system is fair and credible. I believe, as do the NQ21 group, that every qualification should be based on evidence, on demonstrable evidence, in order to be fair and credible. The ACM model that we have does allow schools and colleges to have a wide discretion about the types of assessments that can be undertaken, and that's to ensure that that is fit for purpose for their learners. For example, looking at the range, the timing and the duration of the types of tasks that are available. And I think with that in place, we can be reassured that there is equity and there is absolutely a quality control due to the national standards that underpin all this, to ensure that young people will get the grades that they are entitled to at the end of this process.
I call Pam Gossel to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary, will the new appeals process give universities and colleges the time to prepare for additional students? It's all very well creating additional spaces like she referred to in her statement. However, this process takes time. Speaking to university directly this week, they have raised concerns over the timeframe of reopening. What reassurance can the Cabinet Secretary provide to the universities and colleges across Scotland that the Scottish Government will work with them to provide a route map for reopening safely?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I assure Pam Gosell that we are working very closely with colleges and universities to ensure that there is contact about this part of the process that we're in at the moment and how it will impact on them. And I'd like to thank Universities Scotland for the work that they are doing and for the universities that they will do to provide reassurance to their potential students about the support that's available as they go through this process. In regards to reopening, we were, of course, working very, very carefully with the sector to ensure that universities can reopen safely for students and for staff, bearing in mind the public health limitations that we are under, but we're determined to work with them to do exactly that.
Alistair Allen to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Can I thank the Cab Secretary for what she's said about supporting the mental health needs of students, at which she'll acknowledge will be a difficult time, but can I ask what structures will that support be provided through? Will the expectation be that support around mental health needs is provided through schools, or will the SQA itself take on part of that role?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is a very, very important point which I have looked at carefully. It is very, very important that we do support our young people in this process and that, importantly, they know how to access that. So much of this will be through the school, for example, through mental health counsellors that are available within secondary schools, and that's something which the Scottish Government has supported in the past. There's also a great deal of work that's going on to ensure that we provide further support for staff to support their students, and there'll be new online learning resources published in June. And there's also, we're working with our partners in the Mental Health and Schools Working Group to develop new resources that will provide support for school staff, parents and learners. So there's a number of provisions that are already in place in schools, but there's also new material that we'll be providing to support pupils in turn for their provisional grades being announced at the end of June.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
I'm grateful, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her statement. The SQA have now put up onto their website their appeals process for 2020 to 21, and it runs to two lines, and it lacks detail about the evidence that children will need. There seems to be a process that's going to pit children against the teacher who did the initial assessment, the school and the local authority. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree with her predecessor, who on the 24th of March said that the appeals process would satisfy the requirements of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child? Or does she agree with the Scottish Youth Parliament and the Children and Young People's Commissioner for Scotland, who has said the alternative certification model does not comply with children's human rights?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I do believe that the appeals process does comply with the UNCRC, and that is in particular around the direct right of appeal, which I think to try and portray as pitching pupil against school is both exceptionally unfair and also I think provides a kind of lack of understanding about why this is exactly how you provide the rights for the child, or in this case the young person, by giving them a direct right of appeal. So of course a pupil should have that ability to have that direct right of appeal themselves. They will be able to do that in the circumstances which they choose based on the grounds of appeal that the SQA have set out. The first port of call should, of course, be a discussion with their teacher and with their school around the grades that they have and the reasons behind that, but absolutely they should be supported to take forward an appeal through the grounds that the SQA have determined.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the pandemic has thrown a spotlight on the fundamental role of exams and whether the way in which Scotland has historically certified attainment is right for the future. The Scottish Government has said that it will look at this. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me how that work will be taken forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I mentioned during my statement, we have two pieces of work that are being undertaken by the OECD, and the OECD were specifically asked to expand their work to have that deeper focus on assessment and qualification approaches in the senior phase of curriculum. That's of course been informed not just by what happens here but international good practice. That will be an integral part of the work that we will look at, and I'm sure others will look at, to determine a way forward for this. I'm absolutely sure that we need to learn the lessons of what has worked well, but also to take this opportunity that we have in a post-COVID world to ensure that our system is fit for purpose for the time that we are living in. And I think both OECD reports are an important opportunity that I certainly don't want to lose sight of, to allow reform if that's what the evidence suggests might be required. There will not be one single solution to this, but I look forward to taking part in that process with members here and with stakeholders about what that future might look like.
I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has claimed that teachers are able to exercise their professional judgment in producing estimated grades for pupils. This contradicts the SQA website, which states, "Our key message to learners is that your grades will be judged by your teachers based on your assessment evidence." Who has provided the right advice, Cabinet Secretary? You or the SQA?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think we're in danger of splitting hairs and therefore misinterpreting what I am saying and what the SQA are saying with the best will in the world. There is professional judgment within this process. The professional judgment is a central feature of this assessment process. So, for example, in contrast to an examination diet where teachers are not able to have professional judgment in place, this time teachers have a direct control about the assessment process and the associated outcomes for this year. So, of course, there are national standards, as I've mentioned in the past, to ensure a fair and consistent application for it. But teachers have an important role to play in this year that they would not do in a normal year.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the SQA are aware that there was criticism of communication to pupils, parents and teachers last year, and that decisions taken this year must be communicated with enough time for implementation by schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's absolutely important that whether it's the SQA or any other agency, part of government, looks at the lessons they need to learn around how well we communicate and ensure we're communicating in the right way, to the right people and at the right time. And that's certainly something that I'm determined to do, and I'm sure the SQA are determined to do likewise. I mentioned the letter that will be going out to all learners, which will be very important, but also the other work that will be done with key stakeholders to ensure that they're getting the message that they might want to get across in terms of the support that's out there and the work that can be done with pupils, with parents and with teachers to ensure that they know what's happening, they know why it's happening, they know when it's happening, and they also know the support that's available out them during that process.
I call Claire Baker to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary give an indication of when the appeals process will be completed, as the impact this will have on applications for further and higher education? Student places are dependent on these qualifications, and can they be confident they will get results in time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely, they can. We will ensure that the results are undertaken on a priority basis, so those that are waiting for a result for a place, for example, at a college and university, will be given a priority in that, and during when people are making the appeal, they'll have the opportunity to say that that is indeed the case, and we know, therefore, the SQA will know that that's an important part. Obviously, learners will know their provisional results at the end of June, and the conversations can start then with schools about why they've received that grade and the reasoning behind that. As I say, support is available during that, but absolutely the final grades will be received and determined in time, as will appeals.
And Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My question is also about appeals. Pupils and parents will want to know who is in charge of considering their appeals. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the people undertaking the appeals are the experienced teachers with classroom experience and a clear understanding of the particular environment and circumstances in which the pupils' assessments were taken?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yep. Well, I absolutely appreciate that last year there was a great deal of concern, understandably, that decisions were taken based on algorithms or taken place on past school performance. This year, I can absolutely assure Gillian Martin that those that will be undertaking the appeals process are SQA appointees, subject-specific teachers that know that subject will be able to work through the assessment using their professional judgment and come to a view on the appeal on that basis. So I can absolutely give her that reassurance, and I hope the reassurance to young people that the appeals will be based on the understanding and the professional judgment of teachers.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. I'll allow a moment for people to move. While people are moving, can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the chamber and across the campus? And I ask that members take care to